So good morning, dear friends and colleagues, for this second day of our working session. I hope you have recovered well from yesterday's long meeting, but as I told you, it will not be less today. And I can already ask you to be as precise as possible today in all the interventions so that we can manage there our session well. But first of all, I have the great honor and pleasure at the same time to welcome on behalf of all of you Professor Muhammad Yunus. Please give him a very warm welcome here. Nobel laureate Professor Muhammad Yunus is the father of both the microcredit and social business. He's the founder of Grameen Bank and of more than 50 other companies in Bangladesh. Professor Muhammad Yunus was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in 2006 for his groundbreaking work on microcredit, for demonstrating that by empowering the poorest of the poor, their lives can be transformed. In social business, another concept pioneered by Professor Yunus, the purpose of an organization is to benefit people and the planet in a sustainable way by using business practices. Appreciation for his work is truly global. Professor Muhammad Yunus is the recipient of 59 honorary degrees from universities across 20 countries. He has received 112 awards from 26 countries. Social business is what connects the world of sport with Professor Yunus' work. Our mission is to make the world a better place through sport. Our commercial success allows us to redistribute more than 90% of all our revenues to the sporting movement, benefiting athletes and communities around the world. And in this respect, and also in this respect, Professor Yunus, we welcome you very warmly, and we are looking forward to getting advice from you how we can enhance our cooperation, how we can improve our performance, and how we can contribute together to make this world a better place for everybody. Welcome to the 129th IOC session, and please, the floor is yours, Professor Muhammad Yunus.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. President. Good morning. I'm thrilled to be here this morning, and thank you for your generous introduction. I'm thrilled because I never dreamt that I'll be addressing the top people in the world who energize the entire world, the athletics and the sports world, which has so much power, a limitless power, because it draws the emotion, excitement, the boundaries of human capabilities, and all the hope and aspirations of people. And I never felt that I was part of that. Somehow I felt there's a glass wall. I do whatever little things I can do, but that's a different world than what sports worlds athletics worlds represent to me. That's an enormous power which draws the attention of billions of people on this planet. Nobody else can do that. Not at the emotional level, not at the aspiration level, but this organization does. I admire it from a distance, but never thought there is a way to break that glass wall. Mr. President, you invite me to address this distinguished members of the IOC because you thought that wall can go. Whole world can work together, not kind of dividing up in the sports world and games world and the athletics world and the rest of the world. And that's what I feel strongly too. That's what I would like to share. And to me, sports is something which is basic to human beings. We are all human beings are born with sports and games. Every child in the world, no matter where he or she is born, starts life with games, with the sports. Nobody teaches them. There's no coach. There's no training. It's human being. They design their own sports if they don't know any sports. That's where the children are. And they grow up with that, with excitement. And they build friendship among each other through the sports, through the games, through the everything they play with, dolls and toys and so on, what they got. As they grow up, some of them stay with it, some of them move away from it. And this is something that we don't have to move away from. We can continue to energize that spirit and continue for future. Sports and games are vehicle for peace. And what I do in my work is also something I feel that we work for peace. And I've been talking to people, explaining again and again, the peace is not absence of war. That's not what the peace is all about. It's not absence of armed conflict. Peace is about living together with understanding what IOC and what you represent, saying that it's a harmony in diversity. That's what the peace is all about. But I see that peace is terribly threatened in everyday work that we do in the whole world. And that's what I would like to share with you, how I felt, why I came to that conclusion, that peace is threatened by our own work every day that we do, everywhere in the world. I moved into lending money to poor women in Bangladesh back in 1976, lending tiny little money. That's not what I was planning to do in my life, but I have to get involved with it because of the circumstances, because of the compulsion I felt. The loan sharking that is going on in the village next door to the university where I was teaching. I'm a teacher. Horrible thing that is happening because of the loan sharking. Entire thing from the poor people are taken away by people who had a little bit of money to lend money to those people and grab everything that they got. It's so ugly that if you see closely, you get horrified. But nothing can be done about it. The whole world has that system, loan sharking system. Some call it loan sharking, some call it money lenders. Some call it payday lenders. It's everywhere. But nobody does a thing about it. I suddenly felt that I can do something. I can't just watch it every day. The idea that came, why don't I lend the money myself? If I lend the money myself, then people will come to me and I can lend the money without all those terrible things too, as a consequence. It will be a decent thing, not a horrible thing. And the problem for few people that will borrow from me will be solved. They will not be tortured but the loan sharks. That's what I started doing, taking money out of my own pocket, started lending money to people in the village, and it became very popular. And there's a long story after that. We created a bank out of it, called it Grameen Bank, Village Bank, and it spread all over the country. Right now, we have 8.5 million borrowers in Bangladesh alone of this particular bank, Grameen Bank. It's owned by the borrowers. So 8.5 million borrowers, they are the owners of the bank. And 97% of the borrowers are women, destitute women who had nothing. We came out and gave the money so that she can start her own life, producing something, selling something, earning something, and have self-confidence. They are the owners of the biggest bank in Bangladesh. Today, we lend out over $1.5 billion, or about nearly $2 billion a year to all these borrowers. And step by step, they move out of poverty. That thing became known as microcredit, sometimes called microfinance, spread all over the world. Every single country that you represent, if you dig a little bit, you'll see there are microcredit programs in your country, because they thought it's so important that they have to have it. This is a rich country, poor country, doesn't matter. We started in the United States in 2008, called Grameen America. We lend money to the poor women in New York City who will not get a penny from anybody. No bank will ever go to them. No institution will come anywhere near them. We lend them without any collateral, without any introduction. And that idea spread in many cities in the United States. Now we have 18 branches in 11 cities, in Los Angeles, San Francisco, Indianapolis, Omaha, Nebraska, and so on. We have over 75,000 borrowers, 100% women, and 100% repayment. Nobody defaulted a single loan for a single week. So that is the power. Then it raises many questions. That's what I wanted to share, not the story of Grameen Bank. The question that comes to my mind, why people are poor? Is it the fault of the poor people that they are poor? Or is it the fault of the institutions that we built for the world? So I always come back. It is the institution that we built which caused the poverty. Poverty is not created by poor people. Poverty is created by the system that we built. So we tried to challenge that institution, particularly financial institution. That's the Grameen Bank story. We challenged them. Everything they do, we do the opposite. And it works. They go to the rich, we go to the poor. They go to men, we go to women. They want collateral, we say no collateral. We can build a system on trust. And the whole global microcredit that runs is based on trust. There is no paper. There is no lawyer. Grameen Bank is the only lawyer-free bank in the whole world. And as we do the microcredit, we also got interested in other things, the healthcare. If you are poor, you are poor in health. It goes together, particularly for women. It's a terrible thing that you come close to the women, you see how much they suffer. So what we did, we created a health insurance built into the Grameen Bank. You pay $4 a year for the whole entire family. All your health needs are covered by a medical doctor, by nurses, by lab, pathological lab, everything. And it works. We created hospitals. We created eye care hospital for cataract operation so that people don't have to remain blind because some little surgery was not done to her. We make it very cheap, make it possible that everybody can have it, and want to make sure this is sustainable. It covers all its cost. The first eye care hospital we built came to break-even point in 4 years. Then we are very excited. It's a 10,000 cataract operation per year. We built the second one. Second one came to break-even point in 3 years. Built the third one. This is operating. Fourth one is under construction. So we created a system of business which is different from the conventional business. And I said, why you always have to do the conventional way? Make money. Does business mean that you have to make a lot of money? I said, no, if I don't want to make money, why should I? She created a new kind of business, business to solve problems. And each one that I gave example, the eye care hospital, the health insurance, these are all sustainable businesses, but with no intention of making personal money out of it. And I gave it a name, called it social business. Non-dividend company to solve human problems. And we built one after another. We went to the healthcare of the children. This is a basic problem in any country. Rich country, poor country, doesn't matter. Poor children are malnourished. Either malnourished or obese. Obesity is a major problem in rich countries. So all happens. So we created a social business around it. First, we produced the vitamin A. We encouraged them to produce vegetables so that their children can eat, so that they can have enough vitamin A, so that they don't suffer from the night blindness. This is a disease very common in Bangladesh some 30 years back when we started. And today, night blindness disappeared in the whole country because we are selling seeds for vegetables so that people can grow their own vegetable and feed their children. And it became a very popular action from us. We became the largest seed seller in the country in the process. We didn't go to the doctor to solve all the problems. We just took the responsibility and created the system where they can grow this vegetable and eat and feed their children so that they can take care of night blindness. It became a history. Then we brought the health insurance, as I mentioned. Then we brought a joint venture with Danone, French company, to produce a special kind of yogurt, to put all the micronutrients in the yogurt and make it very cheap so the children can eat it and overcome the problem of malnutrition. And it became a very popular business, as a social business. Danone doesn't want to take profit out of it. We don't want to take any profit out of it. As a social business, we can take back the investment money, nothing more than that. And Danone feels proud of it, that they have done it. And we created a nursing college. And Her Majesty was there to inaugurate that. And that's a social business, joint venture with Glasgow Caledonian University and us. And is the top nursing school in Bangladesh right now. We created joint ventures with Veolia. Water is a big problem all over the world, but Bangladesh particularly. Our groundwater is polluted, and our surface water is polluted, groundwater is arsenic contaminated. So we created a joint venture with a big company, Veolia, French company, to bring safe water in the village and sell it in a very, very small price so that everybody can afford it. And it's sustainable, cover all the cost. That's a social business. So idea of creating an alternative financial system is one that needs to be addressed. And we did that. Idea of creating alternative business to solve the problem, that's what we have promoted, and it's all over the world right now promoting. And these are very important things because of two things I mentioned quickly. One is the poverty that I mentioned, and the continuation of that poverty over years, what will happen in future. You have heard about the population explosion. We have reached 7 billion people in 2011. It took millions of years to come to the first million people on this planet. Millions of years later, we came to 1 million people in the planet, 1 billion people on the planet. No, sorry, 1 million people on the planet. Then it took us another thousands of years to 1804 to reach the first billion people on this planet in 1804, another day. And it took 103 years after that, 123 years after that, to come to the second billion in 1927. And then it took 33 years after that to get to the third billion. And it took 16 years after that to come to the fourth billion. And after that, it's taking almost like 12 years to get another billion. So we'll be in 2022 will be 8 billion. By the time we hit 2050, we'll be 15 billion people on this planet. It's an enormous expansion of human beings. African population will be equal to Asian population by 2000, or the end of 2000, end of this century. But by 2050, it will be 2.5 billion people, doubling what we have right now in Africa. Indian population and Chinese population will be equal by 2050. So this is the kind of explosion of population. What happens? You match it with another information. The system that we follow, all the wealth goes to few people, no matter what you do. You work very hard, everybody works very hard, but the money goes to the rich. 1% of the population of the entire world has more wealth than the rest of the 99% of the people. 1% having more wealth than the 99% of the people. 62 people in the whole world, just 62, you can count by numbers, have more wealth than the bottom 50% of the entire population of the planet. And it's getting worse. If you hear next year, it will be less than 62 people owning more wealth than the bottom 50% of the people. To make it worse, the new income that will be generated this year or any year, more than 80% of the new wealth and the new income will go to the 1% of the people. 20% of the new income will go to the rest of the 99% of the people. 99% sounds big and sounds ridiculous, the share they get. Imagine the bottom 50%, how much they will get. Imagine bottom 25%, how will they get? Nothing. So we cannot continue the system that we have. It's a ticking time bomb. It will create political unrest, unrest among nations. You can see the sign of it now. When the Brexit comes, you can look at it that way. The people at the bottom are very unhappy. You can see Donald Trump in USA. You see why he was popular? Because people are unhappy. Where are our money? We don't know what's happening. They get it everything. We don't get anything. So we have to address that. That ticking bomb has to be addressed. And you have the power. Sports have the power to address that. Because along with what you do, if you break the glass wall, we can look at it. We can energize ourselves. You have such an emotional tie with people. Just a word from you as you promote the social dimension into it, can make things happen. Just to say what needs to be said. And it can be done in many ways. You have celebrities in your system. If the celebrities say, I like social business, immediately young people become very interested. Sports is about young people. Somehow, sports and games are limited to the young people. As you grow older, by physical condition, you cannot participate in it anymore. So it's about youth. You control the youth of the world. What you do, what you say, makes so much enormous thing to them. What you promote is enormous thing to them. Sports defines the human capability. Every year you redefine human capability to go up. And people look forward to it, what you do. When they come to the Olympic, not only they will become national heroes, they become global heroes. There's no distinction where you're from, which caste, which creed, what religion, what political belief you come from. You are our hero. This is one place we get together. So that's the enormous power we have. If the IOC can say, yes, we can promote idea of helping, solving problems in our own way, voluntary way, not somebody is dictating you to do anything. Social businesses. City like Rio, as a part of the legacy, said, okay, we'll do some social business to address the health program, address the unemployed young problem, and so on. Many things can be done. We can discuss about it, how to address the problem of energy in the world, get away from the fossil fuel, can be done. And we have done many of those examples and so on. Each national IOC can have their own social programs. And in that social program, we can put the social business ideas, which runs by itself, it doesn't matter. You can promote joint ventures, like he gave the examples of Danone joint venture, Beulia joint ventures. There are many more, McCain joint ventures, Uniqlo joint ventures with us in many other ways. Just promote, just bring people together. You don't have to do anything because you have the power. You have access to many places which the rest of the people don't have. So this is what you open up the glass door, break the glass door so that you become interested. That's all we need to do. Just get interested in the issue because we cannot continue the world that we have. Last point I'll make. We have young generation in the Grameen Bank borrowers' families. We have been in business for the last 40 years. So there are lots of young people coming up. We gave them education loans so that they can have education. Their mothers, who are the Grameen Bank borrowers, are illiterate women. But we said illiteracy must end with that generation. New generation will be educated. So we gave them education loan, encouraged them to go to school. They did that. So have they, many of them with education loan have master's degrees, many professional degrees, doctors, engineers, and so on. But then they complained, started complaining when the new batches started coming up. We have no jobs. There's no job in the country. What do we do? I started thinking about it. Then I started telling them, why are you looking for jobs? I tell them, job is a very old-fashioned idea. Forget about jobs. Job has to end, was supposed to end in the last century. How come it came back, continued here? You tell yourself that I'm not a job seeker, I'm a job creator. Behave like a job creator, act like a job creator. They get confused. What do I do? I don't have a job. He asked me to become a job creator. I said, look at your mother. She's an illiterate woman. She didn't apply for a job. We're not running around from one place to another finding a job. She took a loan from Grameen Bank to start a business. And ever since, you've been running that business year after year, growing again and again, and that's where you're born. If your illiterate mother can become an entrepreneur, what good is your education if you're looking for a job? You're not believing in your capacity. I said, human beings are about entrepreneurship. They're born as entrepreneurs. When we were in the caves long back, we are not sending job applications from cave number 5 to cave number 10. Do you have a job? They just went ahead and did things. That's in our blood. That's in our capacity. That's what we are. Suddenly somebody said, you have to work for somebody else. I said, human beings are not born to work for anybody else. Human beings are a creative being. Human beings to expand their creative power, not limit themselves by taking a job and they spend the rest of their life in that limited box. So come out, look at the world, big world, create your own business. So today I keep saying this is something that we can overcome, and we created social business. We ask any unemployed young person in Bangladesh, come up with a business idea, we become your partner. We put all the investment needed and let's do the business. You make it successful, return our money, and that's it. You go on your own way. You become an entrepreneur. We are a social business. We don't want to make money out of you. Our job is to launch you into the orbit. That's all we do. Now, thousands and thousands of young people come with business ideas. We provide them the money. We make the investment and let them do the business. So I conclude by saying I pursue three zeros. Zero number one, zero poverty in the world. It has to be done. There's no escape from that. And it can be done. And Bangladesh has proven that. We achieved Millennium Development Goal number one to reduce poverty by half by 2015. We did it by 2013. Our poverty was declined by half by 2013. Now we are set to achieve it by 2030, zero poverty. And I tell people that we want to make sure by 2030, not a single human being in Bangladesh can be called a poor person. There's no reason to be. There's nothing wrong with human being. All we have to do, unleash that creative power and make it happen. And that can be done throughout the world. So we want to make sure we achieve that zero poverty goal. And this is also part of the SDG, Sustainable Development Goals, number one, goal number one. This is a package that we have been pursuing. But in our case, we focus on the three zeros, zero poverty, zero unemployment in the world. Nobody in the world should be called an unemployed person. There's no need to. Why should I wait for somebody else to decide for my fate? I decide my own fate. That's my life. This is what I control. And the word unemployment should become unemployed completely. Nobody has any use for that word. And we can make it happen. Zero number three, zero net carbon emission. We have to do this. There's no escape from that. I'm glad that we came to Paris and signed the agreement to make it happen. So we pursue that three goals. We'd be very happy if IOC and work together. We can work together on SDGs, on three zeros, and make this world happen. And with your power, it will happen much faster than we think. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Yunus. Thank you for being ready to break the glass wall. And I think you have broken it today. You can feel it from the reaction of the audience. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And now, my dear friends and colleagues, Professor Yunus is kind enough to answer questions you may have, so I can invite you to ask questions to him. I have already one, and this is our colleague in Brazil, Professor Yunus. This is Bernard Rajmann, also an Olympian and medal winner, and now the IOC member here in Brazil, our host country. Mr. Rajmann.
Thank you, Mr. President. Dear friends, I would like to congratulate Professor Yunus for his presentation and for his dedication. For sure, it is an honor to take part of this audience. We in Brazil are very engaged with all social and educational programs, and sport has an outstanding role in this process. We are ready to receive your advice, as I realize that we promote the same values in benefit of society. During the Olympic journey, Rio 2016 honored the commitment to accelerate the transformation of the city. We found ways to engage in a series of projects and initiatives to promote social inclusion. Our focus was in employability, professional training, and education. Project Transforma is the educational program of the Games and connected more than 10,000 schools across Brazil, benefiting more than 7 million students and more than 25,000 teachers. Other social progress developed in sync with some of our sponsors involved waste pickers, fishermen, and kids from different communities. My question, though, focus in the future. Professor Yunus, I wonder what would be the best approach to foster social and educational programs based on the Rio 2016 experience for the next editions of the Olympic Games. Thank you, Professor Yunus.
Thank you very much for raising this question. We can discuss in more details on this, but we talk about creating social business cities everywhere. There's an Olympic game taking place. We kind of addressed them to say, would you like to create it as a social business city? Meaning that many of the problems the city suffer, particularly related to the poor, particularly related to poor women and children, or environmental issues, why don't we create one, two, three, four little social businesses? It doesn't have to be mega projects, little projects, which will grow by itself with its own steam, with the thing. So this would be one as a kind of Olympic legacy to create social business cities to make that happen. And Rio is becoming, is already an Olympic city. So we'll very much feel very happy to come and to discuss with you, see what can be done. If you like it, you can do it. If you're not, we can talk about other things. We already have presence in Rio from our side, and also in Brazil. We call it Yunus Social Business Brazil. We work with many organizations here. We have some social business in the favela. We have social business in ESPM curriculum to teach the young people social business. So Brazil has been following many of the issues that we raised in the past, starting from President Lula and later on, promoting President Cardoso. He adopted his wife, particularly Ruth Cardoso, was a big champion of microcredit in this country. So that has been taken root here, but not done as much as it could have been done by creating a bank like Grameen Bank and expand nationally. So there are unfinished work to be done. So we can discuss all these issues together and create instances. And those countries, those cities who are applying for becoming social Olympic city, we can talk to them also. Would you like to create ahead of time, whether you become Olympic destination or not, but you can start a social business, which will continue with you, and remember that you were an applicant or you're a successful applicant, to start it and show that you have done it and you can solve your own problems. This is what the whole thing, we all have problem-solving capacity. Somehow we leave it to the government. Government should solve our problems. Government is only one entity, very limited capacity, cannot solve all the problems we have. Citizens have enormous capacity, limitless capacity with their creative power. But unfortunately, you use our creative power to make money personally. And then our vision becomes very limited. So widen it. You do your thing for personal interest, fine. But in addition, you have enormous capacity to change the world itself. So that, those are the kind of instances that we'll bring forward. Thank you very much for asking the question. Thank you.
Thank you. Next question, Professor Yunus, is coming from James Tonkins. He's a multiple gold medalist in rowing in the Olympic Games and one of the elected athletes representatives we spoke about earlier on together. James, the floor is yours.
I feel very small standing in front of a gold medalist.
Certainly don't.
I never won any medal in any athletics.
Thank you, President. Thank you, Professor. I think it's a very timely reminder of the power that this group has. Certainly, given the discussions that we've been having and the serious nature of those, to remember the power of sport and at the levels that you mentioned, emotional and inspirational. I think that's it's a really, really good reminder and very good and very timely. But my question, and you mentioned a few of the basic human nature. Greed is also part of human nature, and when you create these businesses, how do you avoid those new entrepreneurs of going down that path that you're trying to get rid of?
When we do the new entrepreneurs, the unemployed young people becoming entrepreneur, they run their business to make money for themselves. That's not a social business. They're a regular business. We who support them to become entrepreneurs, we are the social business. We are doing it not to make money out of them. We are doing it to make sure we solve their problems. We are the problem-solving company. We are not against profit-making enterprises. We have said every profit-making enterprise can have a parallel, remember the word parallel, social business. So it's not about all making money. It's about making money for yourself, at the same time changing the world, which is now blocked. You don't do that. So open that up. I said human beings are made of selfishness and selflessness. In this world, we remove the word selflessness in the business world. The only business we have is a selfish business. All I do want to make money, tons and tons of money. I belong to that 1% or 2% people. I said, that is wrong. That's not human nature. Human nature is to open both, to do my thing and at the same time do for the others. I said, making money is a happiness. Making other people happy is a super happiness. But we are never allowed to taste that super happiness. I'm only inviting you to taste that super happiness. You'll be excited. That's why I said this organization is so powerful. It deals with the young people. If they take it in their head, they will do wonderful things. They will do both, selfish business and selfless business. If selfless business is so much more exciting that they are no more interested in the selfish business, that's it. You do that. If this, If the profit-making business is the most exciting thing that you can do, you'll not do social business. But I'm guaranteeing you, making money is happiness, making other people happy is a super happiness. So this is an invitation. We can do both. Continue to do that. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Yunus. Slowly, I'm getting worried about your popularity, seeing the number of colleagues who are asking for the floor. So maybe you wait with your questions before you put forward more questions, and maybe benefit from the opportunity to listen to Mr. Yunus' answers first. So your question may already be answered, because if not, we may have to postpone then the opening ceremony of the Olympic Games there. And I don't know whether this would be very well appreciated.
We don't want to do that.
The next question is Mr. Pound. Professor Yunus, Mr. Pound is the IOC member in Canada.
Professor, it's nice to see you again. I represent one of the 59 universities whom you have, McGill University.
Yes.
And we met, and you had an early connection with Canada at the Jamboree, the Scout Jamboree. And I gave you the micro postage stamp for that. But my question is, have you had any receptivity from the 1%? You know, after you have your first $1 billion, you probably don't have to worry about feeding yourself. Do they understand that they have the power to affect the system?
Yeah, it's very interesting. I'm always welcome among those billionaires. I attend their conferences. I sit down with them on the cover of the Forbes magazine, along with Warren Buffett, Bill Gates, and me sitting together. And all this happens. So I communicate with them. They appreciate what I do, but they're still not gone that far. Some steps have been taken even before me. They created kind of movement for the rich people to donate half their wealth before they end. So this is an initiative. All I tell them, both Bill Gates, Warren Buffett, and others, about 180 billionaires of the world who signed that agreement that they will donate half their wealth before they die. I tell them, donate is fine, but you make it very clear, it's not for charity purposes. I keep reminding, charity is a wonderful thing. That's the only thing that'll help people over years, when everything else is about making money. Charity came to help people. I said, charity has a slight limitation. Charity money goes out, solves the problem, but the money never comes back. So you have only one time use of your money in charity. I said, option that I'm giving, use it as a social business investment. Social business money goes out, does the job, and comes back. Then you can use it again and again. It's an endless use of the same money. It becomes extremely powerful. So I tell the super rich people, and including other rich people, so think about your foundations, think about your money that you want to give it to charity purposes, think about your corporate social responsibility money. Instead of giving to the charity, think about creating social business or create a social business fund so that money goes out. Like I was explaining, all the unemployed young people becoming entrepreneur, their money comes back. So it comes back again. So you reinvest it to a new unemployed person and so on. So you reach out with the same money again and again. So I said, why don't you do that? So that's the negotiation part now goes on. Up to the charity part, they are clear. Then I say again to when I see this super rich people, very friendly people, well-meaning people, I said, look, maybe you should put a date, 50 years, 60 years. I work for myself up to 50 years. When I reach my 50th year, I work for the rest of the world, no more for me. And whatever I earned so far, I devote myself entirely for the rest of the world. I have done enough for myself. So I'm allocating 50 years of my life to myself. That's more than enough for anybody, any individual in the world. Rest of the life, I can do whatever I need to do. And that's excitement I said, people, human beings never retire. The word retirement is not an appropriate word. Human beings are functioning being, creative being until the last moment, last breath. Why stop that creativity? Use this creativity and experience of the first 50 years to make sure you leave behind a world that you really dreamt of. And this is your contribution in doing that. So the world will remember you. So these are the kind of ideas that I try to promote. Some come up with the joint venture initiatives, which is wonderful. And as you mentioned, but the businesses, big businesses coming with joint venture social business. I said, yes, fine, you run your business, but have a social business on the side as an experiment. How does it relate to you? What kind of enjoyment you get out of it? So this is what the Danone and Beulah and all that other things. These are the messages that we kind of exchange with each other. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Yunus. The next question is coming from Mr. Pengili, who is also an athlete's representative.
Thank you, President. Professor Yunus, thank you. That's been fascinating, inspiring, and also very challenging for us, I believe. You highlighted promotion as one of the things that we can do, and both the IOC level and the broader Olympic movement, and also touched on perhaps candidate cities and successful host cities getting involved with social business. What concrete steps do you think we could do as a movement, both internationally and at the national level, for example, our international federations, national Olympic committees, to get more involved with social business? Thank you.
One, this is a very important step that I at least have a chance to make myself understood on what I'm promoting, what I'm proposing. And then follow it up in a smaller group meetings or national level meeting or whatever level meeting, 10 people, 20 people, 30 people together. We can go deeper, day-long program and explaining, answering questions and designing things and so on. Meet with city by city people. Those who are interested, like Rio is right here, we should have a good meeting with them, see what can be done. As I said, it's not an art-shattering thing. It's a very simple thing. Social businesses start very small. And I always appeal to people, always start small and build it up. Build the things and make it big. And I give the examples of Grameen Bank. We started in one village with $27. And now it's a multi-billion dollar bank owned by poor people. Nationally, every single village in Bangladesh, we run business of social business, the microcredit in those. So it became big and it became a global phenomenon. So idea is a seed, you have to germinate it. Once you germinate it, it becomes a victory. So everywhere we talk about, always talk about a small idea that has power to grow and become a giant tree someday. So this is the discussion, and we can form some kind of interactions group of people with how they interact to the facility of IOC. It could be based in Lausanne or anywhere else. Then we can have regional group meetings and so on. And another thing would be helpful if anybody's interested to visit actual social businesses running around the country and around the world. There are social business in Colombia, there are social business in Haiti, there are social business in Albania, Macedonia, Greece, in Tunisia, in Morocco, we are just about to begin, in Uganda, and so on. In India, Bangladesh, of course, in China. So we can come and visit specific things to understand what this is all about. And talk to the joint venture partners, Veolia top people, or Danone top people. Why are you doing this? Are you crazy? What makes you think that this should be done? What is the importance of your business? Are you trying to promote your business to the public by doing this? Or there's some inner meaning to it? So this is the way to go to them, and also through addressing the club level, individual level, group level, seeing that each club can kind of sponsor a social business. It doesn't have to pay its own money. It can organize the money to do that. And as I said, sports is a very short-term thing. It ends in your life, anybody's life, with a very small, early life. What do you do for the rest of the life? So this is one you build about. This is you achieve the glory of being in the center of attention for the whole world. So you have access to all the minds of the world. Use that to change the world. And how do we do that? And you can devote yourself for the rest of the... People will remember you more than what you did in the first half of your life or first one-third of your life, because you have contributed so much, not as a defining the capacity of as an individual human being, as a group of human beings. Also, you define what human beings as a whole do to themselves as a community of the world population. So these are the kind of things. We can start initiating these things one by one, and then kind of another competition. Competition among cities. We have done this. You have done this. Ours is growing faster than yours. This is fun too. We are solving our problem within our own city. City has lots of problems, like any other community has lots of problems. So you define examples, what can be done on each one of them. And globally, if you look at all the problems, these are only few problems. They are not different problems, same problem. You talk about healthcare, you talk about the single mother, you talk about the old people, you talk about the handicapped people, you talk about homeless people, same issue, more or less. So once you do that, we come and learn from you, because you did it in such a beautiful way. Then we want to learn from each other, and in the process, we solve the problem of the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Yunus. The next question is coming from Mr. Morariu, who is the IOC member in Romania.
Thank you, Mr. President. Professor Yusin, I was truly impressed with your presentation, and I think that your voice should be heard by more and more, as many as possible. In an ideal world, what would be the proportion between social business and I would say normal business? Do you think they can cope together? Do you think that maybe one day normal business could disappear to the benefit of social business? As we all know, added value is needed for development, including development for all. Thank you.
I'm glad you raised that question, and I remembered one example. Sometimes I'm invited to Danone's annual general meeting in Paris. They have more than 300,000 shareholders. So they are so proud of the thing they do in Bangladesh, they have done on yogurt to address the problem of malnutrition. So they report to the shareholders, because shareholders are independently owners as a shareholder of that company. So it's not through Danone, but independently they have invested. So they have to get a report from us and from the Danone also. So in one of those meetings, Danone chairman, Frank Dubois, he was saying, I'm so proud of this business that we run in Bangladesh. And I always dream, I hope I can convert the entire, with your support, I can convert the entire Danone as a social business. I'm so excited about it, possibilities and pleasure that I get out of it. So it may come. It has to come from within. So the question you ask, what is the ratio? It is the ratio within our mind, within our heart. What ratio we want to have? That will define the world. How much we want to solve the problem of the world, I can do that. How come I want to solve the problem of mine? What I've already done, these are all marginal issues that I'm dealing with. So why don't I devote myself into doing things? And I kind of as a broad brush, I said, why don't we divide our life into 50-50, 50 years and beyond. 50 years for me, remaining 50 years for the rest of the world. I don't do a thing for myself anymore, because I've decided it's enough. And then I devote myself to this. This is my arbitrary 50 years. You can make it for 25 years. First 25 years, I've done something for me, and the rest of the world, I've done some. Or you want to do it 50-50 all along. Whatever you do in personal businesses or money-making business, same amount of time and energy you put in social business also. It's a personal decision. Everything I'm saying is a personal decision. It's not the government making a law about it. Is not saying IOC will make a declaration to do about it, nothing. It's us, you, me, and my children, and our grandchildren, what we'll do. I have done my part, what my children will do. I have lived enough. Should they work for themselves again to make more money, to belong to the top 1%? Or they will make sure the bottom 1% do not go deeper into bottom rather than go up and become decent citizen in the world, and we take pride in what we have done in our lifetime. This is a personal issue.
Thank you very much. The next question is coming from His Highness Sheikh Ahmad Al-Sabah. He's the IOC member in Kuwait, and at the same time, he's the president of the Association of all the 206 national Olympic committees in the world.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, Professor Yunus, for the excellent presentation and your sharing the experience with us. And I'd like to congratulate you for the success, because it's very difficult. We have suffered to make a success story like this if we are not doing as a charities, and we want to do as a system, a business, and a social help with the small business to increase. A lot of country, not individual, has put a lot of money for this experience, and they failed for that. I'd like to congratulate you for the success of your experience. We will invest your participant with us, Professor, in the sport movement through a lot of my colleagues here, especially the athletes. We have a very special athletes who's retired after to be after they are stars, huh? And some of them they was trying, but they has been retired from the sport because of age or because of energy. And this is one of our main problem, which the athletes committee and a lot of my colleague here start to do some project, how we can bring them back to the society and how we can secure their life for the future. Do you see that through your experience with this mechanism, with this success, how we can put a model for them, because also they will be very benefit for those kind of social project that you are choosing a stars, big names. And in the same time, we are helping our retired athletes to secure themselves. Do you think that through sharing our experience, we can put a model for those retired athletes for the future and for the success of the same social services which you are giving to the societies? Thank you, Professor. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you very much. Well, I've been invited by Amir of Kuwait, and we had a good discussions. Very interested. He was very supportive. And several universities in Kuwait now working with us together to see how they can bring it to the attention of the students so that they can understand what they can do kind of thing. This is also important to the university area. And coming to the athletes, particularly the star athletes, and then retirement comes and they don't know where to go. Many stars, it's a conventional thing, many stars get into the advertising role for companies to promote products and so on. And they see they have their value because people recognize their face and the product goes together, immediately people pay attention. Same thing, you can almost say that the face and idea, not the product, an idea, also can draw attention because they have the value in their image, in their glory that they have brought to the nation, brought to the world. They can now use it for exciting people. So that they still have. So they can use it for promoting this. And we have, like we do in Kuwait, is also many universities in the world now creating what they call social business centers to offer courses on social businesses, organize social business design competition. I want to solve that, for example, a problem is given to the class or given to the whole country, to young people under certain age to compete, to design a business. We want to take the welfare people out of welfare, make them entrepreneurs, make them run, or make them income earners, the job creation for that. What kind of social business you'll design to take 10 welfare people out of welfare, just 10, come up with the business idea. And they come up with hundreds of those businesses. Each one is exciting than the other. And you can pick the top. So invest in those social businesses, see if you can actually take 10 welfare people out of welfare. So if you can, if you know how to take 10 welfare people out of welfare, you can also know how to take 10 unemployed people out of welfare, out of unemployment. Same thing. How to create that business. So university students become very interested in that kind of thing. The reason I'm saying this, if you're one of those retired or half-retired athletes, come to the university campus. Now we are talking to a class. The whole university will listen what's going on, what is to be done. So it's selling an idea. So if one of those athletes say, I love social business, that's enough of a power. Everybody say, what is social business? Why is he talking about that? Everybody will be curious to know what it is. But they're not using that for social purposes. So far, businesses came for good reason to promote their products. I said, I want to use them for promoting ideas. This is a world we have the capacity to rebuild completely in a new design, completely new design. In the design of our dream, it's possible. But we have to believe in it. We have the capacity, but we don't know. Nobody told us that we have the capacity. If the young people start feeling that, yes, I have the capacity, and the young people are lucky because they have the technology too. If the technology and the image and the dream put together, the dream becomes reality. So that's what the role that they can play. Their access to the young people, their access to the business world, how to use it, bringing social changes, making things happen. Not by compulsion, but by inspiration. And they have the capacity to inspire all people. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Yunus. I have still, I think we have to cut it to four more questions, which I had, then unfortunately we cannot accept more, because this will be very, very difficult. So I have Mrs. De Franz, Mr. Kaltschmidt, Mrs. Kochwango-Jaworski, and Mrs. Szewinska. And please, all of you, with a precise question as far as possible. First of all, Mrs. De Franz, whom you have met already when meeting the executive board.
Thank you, Mr. President, and thank you, Professor, for your magnificently optimistic and clear ideas. My question has to do with one of the great problems of poverty, and that is criminality. And how do you help protect these new entrepreneurs from the criminal elements who undoubtedly want to get into their business, as they say?
Yeah. Criminals, drug addicts, terrorists, you name it. These are all human beings. Went into the wrong track completely. Before, we didn't give them the track to follow. Entrepreneurship is a very exciting track, because all we are telling the young people, work hard, get good grades, and you get a good job in a good company. That's the only message we do. And to me, it's the wrong message. So I kind of go beyond people what would like to believe. I said, job is the end of creativity. And it's anti-human being. Human being is all about creative power. And particularly the young people of this generation can expand their creative power, magnify their creative power much more than we ever did because of the technology in their hand. And we are asking them to go and work for 9-to-5 work and follow the instruction of a tiny boss who is overseeing you. And ever since, you're trying to fit to the desire of the tiny boss. That's not what they want. They want to find out who they are. So opportunities will open up. I'm not saying this will be the end of terrorism, end of drug, end of everything else. Quest will be some of them will become excited. If some of them become excited, their friends will become excited. Can we design a social business? This could be a competition subject. Can we design a social business to take the drug addict young people out of drug? Yes, we can. Already they're addicted. But we can design a social business. It's already been done. So how to do that? So this is something. Human creative power brings up all this. We don't say, yeah, we are stuck. Drug is a fact. We can't do anything about it. We can do something about it. We don't give up. That's what the story of all the sports. We don't give up. We continue. We persist. We endure. So this is what the story. So how to make it happen and make sure nobody gets into the new drug. First the old drug and the new drug. And similarly for the criminals also. There is one social business in Japan already done. We are associated with it.
this is very interesting, and also I'll refer to example in USA also. Their worry is young juvenile criminals get convicted, sent to jail, and they do their time and come back. And you can guarantee a few months back, a couple of years back, they're back again. Because they have learned everything inside the jail. And they come out, they have no place because they are convicted criminal. Nobody gives them a job. And there's only opportunity for them. There's nothing else because the world has never taught that he can be an entrepreneur. No institution has been built. No financial institution in the world will give a loan to an unemployed young person. We do that all the time. And our money comes back. And they are proud of it. That's what the microcredit is all about. Nobody in the world will give a penny to all these women. We give them billions of dollars without any papers. The money comes back. Same thing in the USA. They say, oh, Bangladesh is a crazy country. They do it all kinds of. Look at the USA. We do the same thing in the USA. No papers, nothing. But the money pays back 100% without fail. So this is what we have done. So don't give up. So these things can be done. Design things so that they can come out of the problem they had come. So the Japan has done, created social business, start working while they're still in jail. Consulting with them, discussing with them, making their plans, what they will do when they're out. And then social business starts creating these opportunities to become business person and whatever other person, so that they don't have to go back again. In the US example, this is a big issue in the US also, juvenile. One study shows the money spent on a young person who is convicted for the first time, for the rest of his life, coming back again and again, the total money government spends on them, if they spent right in the upfront, they could have given him all the way from secondary school to the Harvard PhD with that money. But instead, they're only paying for their jail sentences. This is again a mismatch of the whole initiatives and so on. So this is the idea of what we can do. I'm not saying every effort will become successful, but we keep on doing that. There's absolutely no reason why it will not be successful. It's all about human beings. We are not born as a criminal. We are not born as a terrorist. Society made them so, made us turn into that direction because there was no other direction for me. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now, the next question is coming from Mr. Kaltschmidt, whom you have also already met.
Thank you, Professor. Thank you for enlightenment words. When people become from poor, they become self-sustainable and more educated. There's a lot of benefits. One of the benefits is the education, is the protection of the environment. I have been in Haiti, I have been in my country, and I've seen how poor people need to cut the trees for fuel, for everything. What is your experience in Bangladesh when people are changed from being poor to, so what is your experience on the protection of the environment?
You mentioned Haiti and cutting of the trees. I had this experience when I came to Haiti for the first time to start the social business. And I was very amazed by the things that I heard, things that I saw. Haiti lost all its forest. It has about 2% of the forest left now because people are cutting off the trees to make charcoal for cooking. By 1985, they had still 25% of the forest left in 85. Today it's 2%. And they tell me it's fast declining. Even 2% will disappear in the next 6 to 7 years. So I look at it, I said, look, you're cutting the tree for making charcoal, for cooking. Is there any way to find something else so that you don't have to cut the trees? This is one. And they told me that if you fly over the island, as long as you see green underneath, you know you're in Dominican Republic. The moment you see barren land, you have entered the airspace of Haiti. I said, even the same island, people can keep it green. What's wrong with you? What happened? No answer. No good answer.
So what we did in my first visit, we organized meetings with the government officials, with our civil society activists, and we created a new company, social business company, among many other companies that we have done in the meantime. This is a new company we launched called Haiti Forest. The goal of this company is to reforest entire Haiti in a business way, in a social business way. Could be done. I said, forestry is the most income-generating activity you can ever see. It generates income every day. How come you just take it away? You don't chop off your mango tree because it gives you mango. Because you know that if you keep it alive, it gives you mango and you make money. I said, the forest is the same thing. Forest as a whole gives you many, many resources. But somehow, it's mismanaged. All attention you have is to cut them, make charcoal, and forget about it. Don't think what will happen after you have chopped up all the trees. So this is one way, Haiti and all that. In Bangladesh, I give you an example of Bangladesh. You asked me to do that. But 25 years back, we have been talking about the terrible situation of electricity in Bangladesh. At that time, Bangladesh doesn't have much of electricity. 75% of the people have no access to any electricity. Villages particularly, because Bangladesh is all villages. So when the light goes off, or when the sun goes down, the whole country becomes dark. Only little kerosene lamps come over, take over. So it's such a flimsy light, you hardly see anything. So you feel ashamed that you are still in the cave age. You have not changed your life much. I started talking to people who were promoting solar energy and so on. I said, is it possible to bring solar energy in Bangladesh where there is no electricity? They said, no, it's not possible. It's too technologically oriented, something people will not understand. It will be too expensive. It's good for Europe. It's good for North America, but not for Bangladesh. I said, whether it's good for Bangladesh or not, I'll decide, can you explain to me how it is all done? Because I don't know anything about it. So explain the technology of it. And I decided to create a social business company to bring solar energy in the villages. Everybody said, this is not going to work at all. You're a big failure. I said, well, I'll keep on trying. I don't have a guaranteed success, but I'll learn in the way. Started it 22 years back. In the beginning, selling 2 or 3 solar home systems per month was such a big struggle. People say, this is crazy. You waste of money. Who ever heard of making electricity out of sunshine? He wants to make money out of this. So people are very reluctant to try it out. They said, well, it may run for a week, maybe a month, then it will stop again. And we are wasting our money. So we have to gain their trust that it will work. We said, this is experimental, you try out. How many months? 3 months. Okay. If it gives 3 months, will you buy it? Maybe. Okay, you try it out. So that was 22 years back. And from then on, we sold 10 more solar home system per month, 50 solar home system per month, 100 solar home system per month. We got very excited. We are doing good. Then about 18 years later, we started selling 1,000 solar home system per day. We have now nearly 2 million households in Bangladesh with solar energy running every day. This is with the Grameen Energy Company, a social business company. Seeing the success of Grameen Energy or Grameen Shakti, many other NGOs, many other companies got into business. We are very happy that everybody is trying to do that. In total, we'll have about 3.5 million homes right now in Bangladesh with solar energy. Electricity from the grid has not come yet, but we have the solar energy solution. Now people come up with use of solar energy for other purposes. So this is it. So again, we have replaced fossil fuel, kerosene, by renewable energy. Once the renewable energy comes in, many other things happen. Now irrigation is coming up with solar energy because there is no electricity. So you now connect the pumps in the fields so that you can grow a dry season crop. Otherwise, there's no way. You have to have either tube wells, which is run on diesel, which is very expensive. Solar is much cheaper, much efficient, and you can have it anytime you want. So these are the kind of things. You bring one after another. Not that we have tried out everything yet. So I said, if you all join together, there's many more exciting things to come. That's the future for us. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next question is coming from Mrs. Kochwango Jaworski, who is the IOC member in the Philippines.
Thank you, Mr. President. Hello, Professor Yunus. Thank you for being with us today. I will try to be precise, but it's making me nervous to think how to be precise. The actual question is short, but there's some explanation. In 2009, the corruption level in our country was extremely oppressive, and it was very difficult to see that there were more people who were complaining rather than trying to think of how they could be part of the solution. And I was part of a group that felt very politically helpless and disconnected. And none of us were business people. We had no idea how to run a business. And we knew that we couldn't go into the communities to try to teach business because we can't teach what we don't know. But we felt very strongly that the problem we were facing was commercialism and materialism. It was changing the values of society and priorities and human relations. So we had this idea and put together a group whose name translated means what is your stake. And we decided that we would turn the skill into the currency in the communities, meaning that if you're a carpenter or a doctor or a plumber, a teacher or a sports coach, you would be offering your services in exchange for the services of someone else. And we wanted to do this to show to people that we are interdependent and we are accountable to each other, because as human beings, we are meant to be connected, but greed makes us unknowingly take things away from each other without even knowing it and destroy trust and relationships and no money to go around anyway. So in 2009, we started this group. We were detoured in 2010 because we were all suddenly called to a different mission, but now we have been talking about reviving this. And my question is that, do you think this is naive? Do you think this is something that could grow into a giant tree? Or is this something that would not be sustainable in the long run? Thank you, Professor Yunus.
Thank you. The answer is yes, of course. Again, the design at the early stage is the most important part. If you're designing as a social business, you have to have certain characteristics in it. Everybody understand that this is a business. If people get the idea this is a charity work, it's very difficult to turn it around into business, because the mentality of the charity work is very different. I'm not saying it's wrong. This is appropriate for that work. But for business, it has to be appropriate for the business thing. That I have to, at the end of the year, I have to look at my book, see how much money I have earned, how much money I spent. And is there a deficit? Is there a surplus? If in the year one there is a big deficit, that's fine. All businesses have that. But in the second year, is this deficit becoming smaller? That's the test. In the third year, if the deficit becomes still smaller, then you're on the right path. Someday, your earning and the expenses and earning will be even. So you come to the break-even point. And from then on, one will cross the other. And that's like you have entered the real business world. But every business has to go through this. Are your people clearly understand this point? Measure everything they do in terms of money, that this is the money we get. In the beginning, you do things to promote, it's possible. But your goal has to be very clear. So once they understand what your goal is, that has to be in their mind, everybody's mind. I have to save every penny that I can. I have to serve the people and get paid for it. And that's very important part of it. So this is how it should be done. Once you design the first one, the little one, right, then the rest is the replication. Repeating the same thing that you have done over and over again. In the repetitive process, you learn from each experience and make it more efficient. And ultimately, you see you have done it not only within your country, it is spilling over everywhere, because your solution is not a local solution. Your solution is a global solution. As I said, problems what you face, problem anybody else faces, is the same. Simply, it's in a different color and a different context, that's all. Otherwise, essential part of it is the same thing. So when you find a solution, immediately whole world will be coming at your door to see how you have done that. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Yunus. And now we come to the last question we can accept here. And knowing Mrs. Szewinska, who is also a gold medalist and the IOC member in Poland, she can be extremely precise if she wants.
Thank you, Mr. President. Professor Yunus, I am absolutely impressed by your presentation, and I would like to congratulate to you what are you doing. I read about this before, so it is a great honor for me to meet you personally here. My question is very short and simple, I think. I am very interested, what is going on with these people who started with social business after 10 years, 20, 30, with these people and their families? Because some of them, I understand, they are successful people. Maybe not all. I'm interested in how it is. Look, thank you.
Yes. Well, first of all, is the design of the business is important thing, because the objectives are different. This business has objective to solve the problem, unlike the conventional business. I tried to explain it. I said, you can almost look at this business as what we call social business as the objective of charity, but backed up by a business machine. You attach a business machine to an objective of a charity. Suddenly it becomes very powerful. So your objective is the very critical part, and the design is appropriate to achieve that objective with the business machine that is set into there. So those who are designing it, those who are first test running it on the ground to see it works, they are the critical people. In the process, you hire plumbers, you hire mechanics, you hire engine room guy, you hire accountant, you hire IT persons. They are just regular IT persons. They just work whatever business. They have no idea of social business to begin with. They just took a job because in the market, this is an IT job available, and I was applicant in three different places, and you are one. So I took an IT job, and I do the IT job. You gave me all the assignments, I do it. I'm not trained as a social business IT. I'm trained as an IT. But the guy who's designing, he has to be trained as a social business designer. That's very important part. So the rest of it is a conventional thing all the way. So the guy who sweeps the floor, he sweeps the floor, just like any other office. He doesn't know. But once they understand what business they are working for, they feel proud. They know if I have an IT job in another company, which is a business making money, and this IT job in a social business, they're offering me the same salary, same facilities, I will accept the social business IT job. Because not only I get the same emoluments, but at the same time, I'm doing something for people. So I get an additional advantage in that. So this is how it continues. And once you are successful as a designer, you don't want to quit. You want to design another one, more powerful than what you have done before. Because it's so attractive. It's almost grabs you. It pulls you in. You cannot get it out of it. It intoxicates you, to be direct. It's so enjoyable, it's so inspiring to do those kind of things. So you move on to do something else, you feel that you have the capacity to do that. Before anybody does it, you want to be the first. So I would not say that people will quit and do something else. Enough of social business. It's very difficult to walk away from social business once you have done it. It pulls you in and makes you to show your creative power in many other ways. It's all about what you have inside of you. You are discovering yourself in the process, who you are. You are defining yourself, who you are. And that you enjoy seeing the boundaries and then see that expanding boundaries of yourself. That amazes you that you have this kind of thing. Thank you.
So thank you very much, Professor Yunus.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Yunus. I think you have achieved 100% of your objectives. You made us super happy with your really inspiring speech, which gave us and gives us all a lot of food for thought. And I can already threaten you that we will call you in the near future to discuss some ideas you gave us today during this presentation, which was really inspirational and can help us a lot also to address the social challenges we have also in the world of sports. So thank you very much again. And now that you have broken the glass wall, you're always welcome here in the Olympic family and here at the International Olympic Committee. From today on, we consider you to be one of us. Thank you very much.